What a blessing. Hey, just a couple other quick things. On the back by the door, you'll see there's a repeal the bathroom rule petitions. And you can feel free to either sign a petition, fill it out, or even grab a few. And there's a sheet on top if you're going to take some to kind of check them out. And there's a date on the back of July the 5th, I believe it is, that these need to be turned back in. You can either just mail them directly or return them here to the church and we'll mail those in. You know, and this is part of just being the light in our culture, being the light and living in a republic, a democratic system, the democratic republic that we can partake. Also, talking about being the light, somebody donated these little flashlight pens that have, you know, the name of Simple Faith on there. They're actually, they were given so you could take one and give them away and invite somebody to come to fellowship here. So those are on the back as well. So just want to remind everybody that those are there. Hey, let's open our Bibles this morning to the book of Jude as we continue verse by verse through the Bible. And we're in the book of Jude right now. And we go verse by verse through a book on Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights. We go chapter by chapter. Actually, even this Wednesday night, just to remind everyone, it's our praise, prayer, and worship night. We incorporate our prayer time and our praise and worship time. We'll also be having communion. Just a great time to come together and just have that agape feast. Just coming together to worship the Lord and to celebrate Him. So just want to remind you of that. And if you've never been, boy, you've been missing it. What a sweet time that is. Jude, and we're going to be looking at verses 3 and 4 this morning in the book of Jude. Verses 3 and 4, if you're having a hard time, it's right before the book of Revelation there. Let's go ahead and read that and then we'll pray. Jude, verses 3 and 4. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain people have crept in unannounced or unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation, ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, as we open your word this morning, Lord, once again, may the words penetrate our hearts and our minds, Lord. May you find good soil here this morning as we come, ready to receive your word, Lord, expecting to hear from you by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So now as we come to the book of Jude, we actually come here, especially, in verses 3 and 4, but we come to the theme of the book of Jude. You know, as he takes basically a brief look, but a firm stand as well against those who would creep into the church, who would seek to have people, have the sheep of God, to go astray from the moorings of the simple yet deep word of God, the faith and the lordship of Jesus Christ. And what's interesting is we read through this letter, even though it's almost 2,000 years old, I feel like it could have been written yesterday. Amen? I mean, you read these words and how profound they are today. Again, let's start here in verse 3. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation. Let's stop there for just a moment. You know, Jude was, you can tell, he was originally going to write to them just about something kind of upbeat. Their common salvation. Hey, you know, I just wanted to write you about that. And it reminds us, you know, of what Paul wrote to the church in Corinth. Let's turn over there to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Something familiar to this or like this. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1. First Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 5. Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received and in which you stand, by which you are saved if you hold fast to the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. So Paul's talking about their common faith. Verse 3. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. That's the common faith. That's part of what, you know, Jude is writing here. Hey, I just simply wanted to write you things about our common faith, things that, you know, the Lord has shown us, and basically to upbuild them in their faith. And yet, you know, we don't know what else he wanted to talk about, but he wanted to talk about their faith, their common faith. And basically now he's saying, look, you know, now I can't do that anymore because there's certain things going on within the church. There's certain things that I need to address. And he continues in verse 3, hey, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. So, hey, I wanted to write to you about our common salvation, but I'm finding it necessary that I need to write to you and exhort you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered for the saints. In the NIV, it says this, I felt I had to write to you and urge you to contend for the faith that was once for all entrusted to the saints. The New Living Translation says, but now I find that I must write about something else, urging you to defend the faith that God has entrusted once for all time to his holy people. The Amplified says it like this, but I found it necessary and was impelled to write to you and urgently appeal to you and exhort you to contend for the faith which was once for all handed down to the saints, the faith that is the sum of Christian belief which we delivered verbally to the holy people of God. The New American Standard, I felt it necessary to write to you appealing to you that you would contend earnestly for the faith that was once for all handed down to the saints. And lastly, in a paraphrase, he says, I have written to you insisting, begging that you would fight with everything within you for this faith entrusted to us as a gift to guard and to cherish. Can I have an amen? Amen. Amen. You know, it's funny because I read that over and over because I think we need to hear it in different ways. Amen? We need to hear it in a way that, look, the word, it says contend earnestly in the New King James. And basically, it's a compound word in the Greek, and it's epigonitsomai. And it's from epi, the Greek word, and it's also from agonitsomai. And if you might kind of think about it there, we get our word agonize from the Greek word agonitsomai. We're to be agonizing over the faith. We're to be earnestly contending for, to struggle for, literally in the Greek, to fight for something specific, to exert intense effort on behalf of something, to fight for. You know, I just read the other day that one of the fellows that was one of the last surviving guys that survived the surprise attack by Japan in Hawaii, he died just the other day. People who fought for something, they call that the great generation who would fight for our country, would die for our country. And Paul is talking, it's like, look, I found it necessary, you know, to write you, exhorting you, lifting you up, almost pushing you out to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. They weren't simply to fight to win an argument. Notice that, what he says there. You know, he doesn't say, hey, just, you know, contend earnestly with one another. Just fight amongst yourself. He doesn't say, hey, you know, let's just go out and argue with people. He says, no, I want you to contend earnestly for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. You know what's interesting? We're to fight for Christianity. We're to fight for the faith that we've been delivered. Can I say, have an amen?
Amen.
Amen. You know, it's so funny. So many people out there today are fighting for so many causes. Yesterday, there was people fighting in the streets, you know, at a Trump rally, fighting against Trump. The other day in Costa Mesa, people are jumping up and down on cars, you know, and they're looked at by much of our culture as heroes for fighting for what they believe in. Yet you have a million people go to Washington, D.C., and they protest abortion. and it's not covered at all. They're not heroes. Matter of fact, we think they're haters. They're trying to take away women's rights. Can I have an amen? It's crazy. Most times they even lie about the numbers. You see, it's so funny. You see this vast, huge picture video. I mean, just you can tell hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people. And they say, there was about 10,000 people at the lawn there. You know, it's like 10,000. Are you crazy? And again, they don't care. But let's go even deeper. Notice what he says they were contend for. He says to contend for the faith. To contend for the faith. And again, wants to notice, hey, this isn't just for guys and gals that are apologists within the church. This isn't just for the pastors and the teachers.
Yes, Pastor Bill, make sure you pay attention now. This is for you. Because you represent me out there.
Hey, I don't represent anybody here. That's not my job. That's not my job. It's not. It's not my job. My job is to equip you for the work of the ministry. And when Jude is writing here, he's not writing to some obscure people out there like Hank Canagraph or other guys, you know, Don Stewart or other people that we might think. He's writing to you and to me, young, old, married, single, male, female.
Well, I did my fighting when I was younger. I'm retired from the Christian faith now.
Nice try. Nobody retires. The day we retired is when we're reading some words over your body and it's in the ground because you're home with Jesus. And you hear those words, good, well done, good and faithful servant, because you realize there is no retirement. We are to, young and old, we're to be contending earnestly for the faith. Again, in the Amplified, you know, it says, the faith which is the sum of the Christian belief. Again, in the New Living, urging you to defend the faith that God has entrusted once for all time to his holy people. They were to contend, to fight for with exerted, intense effort for the faith that had been left, the letters, the gospels, the word of God that they have been entrusted with. You know, it's interesting, the faith is a very important thing throughout the Bible. Let me just throw some references. You can read, write them down and I'll read them to you. Romans chapter 1, verse 5. Through him we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among the nations for his name. Titus chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ for the sake of the faith of God's elect and their knowledge of the truth, which accords with godliness. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 7. So that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Amen? 3 John verses 4 and 5, I have no greater joy, John wrote, than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Beloved, it is a faithful thing. Isn't that awesome? The faith, and we are to be contending for the faith, fighting for the faith. We live in a culture today that tries to make you and I ashamed of our faith. Can I have an amen? Hey, from the time you're young, if you're going to school, you know, they start to make you feel ashamed if you're in kindergarten, even preschool. And it's starting, you know, even then to make you ashamed for being a Christian. You're a bigot, you're a hater. And it goes on. It's not just there. All of a sudden you go and you turn on the music and you hear people, whether they're old musicians or young musicians, it's like they all get together and say, if you're, you know, not liberal and if you're not corrupt in your morality, then you're not allowed to be a musician. And they tell you, hey, don't force your Christian values on me. Amen? Do you realize that when they say that, don't put your values on me, they're putting their values on you? We don't see it a lot of times. Oh, well, I'm not trying to offend anybody. I'm not trying to be contentious. Hey, Jude is telling us to contend for the faith. Sometimes we will be called names, contentious, mean. You know, you guys are judgmental, hypocrites. And so sometimes we'll just be quiet. Can I ask you a question? When's the last time you contended earnestly for the faith once for all delivered to the saints? Hey, I understand that we don't want to be looked at as grumpy all the time, and somebody says, you know, they're at work and they say, oh my gosh, and they say, hey, don't say oh my gosh because that's close to oh my G-O-D, and you know, come on. We need to be wise. We need to have wisdom. But on the same point, if you haven't contended earnestly for the faith, if you haven't had somebody get mad at you for a while for your faith, you need to examine your faith, brother. You need to examine your faith, sister. Because if we haven't offended somebody for the faith, then we're not living the faith that God has called us to live. Jesus guaranteed it, by the way. How many people here like the Sermon on the Mount? Raise your hands. How many? No, people? I like the Sermon on the Mount. Sorry, some of you guys don't. But some of those are called the Beatitudes. Anybody like the Beatitudes? Turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5, please. Man, we love the Beatitudes, right? You know, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. I love all that stuff. But we always tend to cut it off right there at the end, right? Verse 9, Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. Give you a moment to turn there. Matthew 5, verse 9. We cut it off here. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. And we're like, oh, amen. Because we have all the other stuff. Oh, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who mourn, the meek. Blessed are those who hunger for righteousness. Blessed are the merciful. Right? But we always kind of seem to forget to go to verse 10. Look at verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And guess what? Jesus didn't stop there. He goes on to the next verse. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Do you have any amen? Amen. Amen. When's the last time we were persecuted? When's the last time we contended earnestly for the faith? Beloved in Christ, let's stop being ashamed of the faith. Let's stop being ashamed of being a Christian. Now again, that doesn't mean, hey, okay, everybody, let's go out and be jerks for the Lord. Amen? You know, get a little bumper sticker, I'm a jerk for the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. And to be honest, there are some Christians out there. There's a lot of professing Christians out there. They're just jerks. They think they're doing it for the Lord, but they're not doing it for the Lord. Now look at verse 4, back in our text in Jude. Because he goes on and he says he gives the reason why they have to contend earnestly for the faith once for all delivered to the saints. And this is the same reason today. Verse 4, for certain people have crept in unnoticed who long ago were designated for this condemnation. Now we're going to talk about this part, the long ago designated for condemnation, when we get to verses 5 through 11. Okay, but we're going to continue that. Notice that certain people have crept in. These people have crept into the church. Now, these certain people, look at verse 8 there in Jude. We see what these people do. They've crept in, and verse 8 says, yet in like manner, these people also, relying on their dreams, defile the flesh, reject authority, and blaspheme the glorious ones. So these are the people that have snuck into the church. Verse 4 continues, ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny the only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Now again, I feel like this letter could have been written last night, this morning, about the church today. But Jude saw this was even happening in the church almost 2,000 years ago. Notice what it says here, that there were people creeping into the churches unnoticed. Now think about animals that creep. You know, I've always liked the big cats, you know, lions and leopards and, you know, those are, they don't creep, man. They just kind of, they're cool, they're sleep. But the ones that creep are like the snakes. They kind of creep on the ground, or the, you know, the lizards. And I know spiders, they don't really, you know, they don't really creep, but they're creepy, right? So they kind of go thrown in there. I hate spiders, dude. But these are the same kind of thing. These people are, notice again, creeping into the churches unnoticed. Notice there's an intent here. This isn't they just wandered into the churches. It's not that they, you know, oh, just to get a little check out of church. No, these people are intently coming in, and they are intently bringing biblically doctrine that is biblically off. They are coming to mess up the church. They are creeping in, and nobody is noticing. They have come unnoticed by the sheep and even by many shepherds today. Saw a picture the other day, actually a video of a fellow who was dressed up like a woman and calls himself transgender, and he was standing at a Baptist pulpit preaching the Word of God. And he was saying basically how wonderful the life of sin is. They're creeping into our churches today, I believe more than ever, more than I've been a Christian. Turn to Matthew chapter 7 with me, please. Jesus spoke of this very thing. Matthew chapter 7. Matthew 7, verse 1. Judge not that you not or be not judged. Nope, sorry, that's the wrong one. That's the favorite one by many people out there, the only verse they know. They take it out of context, just like Satan takes God's word out of context as Jesus was tempted in the wilderness. We'll be looking at Matthew 7, verse 15. Jesus said this, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them." Guess what? That takes judgment, beloved in Christ. Jesus said later that when we judge, we are to judge righteously. That means we are to judge in accordance with the Word of God. So when we come, even as you come this morning, you take what I teach and preach and you hold it up to the Word of God. Has Bill creeped in? Is he bringing this, you know, these bad messages? But notice we're told here again in Jude that they're not just creeping in, they're creeping in unnoticed. Why are they unnoticed? Because we have so many professing Christians today who are biblically illiterate. Men and women who profess Christ, but we are not reading our Bibles. We are not studying our Bibles. You know, I've used this example before, but for a few years I was a teller at a bank down in Newport Beach. And it was so interesting because, you know, they never brought up a lot of counterfeit money and said, okay, you need to see this counterfeit bill. Look at that counterfeit bill. Oh, here's another way. No, what they did is, let's teach you how to see the real money. The real money has fibers that if you take a little bit of spittle and you put it on there and you rub on a fiber, guess what? That one fiber will rub off. You know, nowadays they have all these other things. And it came to be as you worked with money, you would just go and you're counting. And I was a vault teller for a while, and I'm literally counting hundreds of thousands of dollars a day. And 24, 60, one, blah, blah, blah. And all of a sudden one day I'm doing a talk, you know, hey, how's it going? And I'd say, oh, what was that? And I stopped in this pile of 20s. And I'm like, something's off. Something's off. This doesn't. And all of a sudden, guess what? I hold it up to the light. I'm doing the test. And it was a forged note. It was a forged $20 bill. And I didn't know it because I was looking for the false thing. I knew it because I knew the real thing. You see, beloved in Christ, I'll be honest, as a pastor, it kind of used to be able to keep up with the Benny Hinn's. Used to be able to keep up with the Hagins and the Marilyn Hickeys and all these people who were off biblically. But to be honest, I can't keep up anymore. Even as a pastor. You know, I know guys that are in, you know, discernment ministries, and they're, oh, do you know that this guy's bad or that gal's bad? Or that? And it's like, well, what are you talking about? And you start to hear, oh, wow, I didn't know they were teaching that. I didn't know they had written that. I did. And because it's getting so prevalent. So if you notice, I don't sit up here and, well, let's look at all the things that we need to look at and not be deceived. Let's look at, you know, Calvary Chapel Ready, or not Calvary Chapel Ready. Let's look at, you know, Bethel in Reading and Bill Johnson and how, you know, he's a false teacher and, you know, it's a whacked out church biblically. And let's go and look in depth. We don't need to do that.
Why don't we need to do that? Because we become men and women of the Word of God. The people that are going to those churches, like, you know, Bethel and others, they're being deceived because they're not men and women of the Word of God. Hey, I've even heard of Calvary Chapels. Let's take a little trip up to Reading and go to Bethel. You mean Barfel? What is it? Because they're not discerning. They're not going, hey, this never happened in the Word of God, but it's happening all over there. Hey, I never read in the Word of God about feathers coming down because angels are worshiping with us. Hey, I see you up there, dude. Yeah, check it out. Hey, there's another guy over there. What's that? Oh, he's got some, you know, angel dust. It's not really angel dust. He went to the 99-cent store and got some sprinkle stuff. Sparkly stuff. And God's people are fooled. And because we're not men and women of the Word of God, we don't know. So they come in, and these false teachers, they're slithering into the churches, and they're unnoticed because so many of us aren't men and women of the Word of God. Some of you just depend on this hour a week for all of your Bible teaching. Guess what? You're going to get fooled one way or another. Maybe you're being fooled even now. We need to be men and women of the Word of God. Because we contend earnestly for the faith that has been delivered to us. Jesus said in Matthew 5:17, hey, don't think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth have passed away. By the way, have heaven and earth passed away yet? Anybody? Ain't happened yet. Not an iota, not a jot, not a tittle will pass from the law until all is accomplished. That's the word of God. Can I have an amen? Amen. Turn with me, please, to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Starting in verse 1. But understand this. That in the last days, now notice that Timothy goes all the way, Timothy goes all the way to the last days. In the last days, there will come times of difficulty. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy. Verse 3, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. Avoid such people. For among them are them that creep into households and capture weak women, burdened with sins and led astray by various passions. Always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of the truth. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so these men also oppose the truth. Men corrupted in mind and disqualified regarding, notice this, the faith. But they will not get very far, for their folly will be plain to all, as was that of those two men. Verse 10, you, however, now notice he changes here. You, however, have followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and suffering that happened to me at Antioch and at Iconium and at Lystra from persecutions I endured. Yet from them all the Lord rescue me. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Jesus, Christ Jesus, will be persecuted. While evil people and imposters go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, here's our admonition, everybody. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believe, knowing from whom you've learned it, and how from childhood you've been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise. Notice, make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. It is the sacred writings. Verse 16, all scripture is breathed out by God, profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work. Can I have an amen? Can I have an amen? A real amen? Come on. Amen.
Hey, this is us. We need to be those as people are creeping into the church that we know. Back in our text, who long ago were designated for this condemnation, ungodly people, notice, who pervert the grace of God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Jesus said in Luke chapter 17, verse 1, he said to his disciples, temptations to sin are sure to come, but woe to the one through whom they come. It would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were cast into the sea than that he would cause one of these little ones to sin. You see, Jesus knew it was going to happen. Paul knew it was going to happen. Peter knew it was going to happen. Jude saw it happening. You know, but notice how within our text here, Jude calls these people two things. They are condemned, notice, and they are ungodly. And why are they condemned and ungodly? Notice, it says, because they are perverting the grace of our God into sensuality, and they are denying our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Perverting, notice it says there, they're perverting the grace of God. I told Talia years ago, I thought of a great title for a book. Taking grace for granted. And just like about how we as Christians can so easily take the grace of God and pervert it into our own image, if you will. Well, God doesn't care if I do this or if I do that. God doesn't care about this and that. And to be honest, that's exactly what this is talking about. Literally, their perverting is basically changing or altering. And notice, you know, the grace of our God into sensuality. And also, they're denying their Master, their Lord and Master, Jesus Christ. Notice, they pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny. The first thing they do, they pervert the grace of God into sensuality. One commentator said this. He said, in other words, they were gutting the faith of its moral imperatives. Gutting the faith of its moral imperatives. Is that happening anywhere today? Anybody? Amen. I don't know about you, but I love the faith in Jesus. You know, I can't even say this. There's a lot of people who love their faith in Jesus, but they don't like the moral imperatives that come with it. They like the grace, in other words, amen. Hey, I'm saved by Jesus. I'm going to heaven. Praise God, hallelujah. Well, what do you mean I have to do these other things? What do you mean I can't do this anymore? Well, that doesn't sound like fun. That doesn't sound like grace. Matter of fact, I think that's legalistic. I think you're legalistic for saying it. Hey, I'm not saying it. It's God and His Word. Don't argue with me. Argue with God. Can I have an amen? Amen. Amen. Whether we like it or not, we all have a tendency to want to get the gospel and go to the good stuff. I mean, go through and look at most of the things we highlight in our Bibles. You know, be strengthened by the grace. This is me. I have this highlighted. Be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And that's great to highlight. Those are great and wonderful things. We need to look at those, but we also need to understand why we're strengthened by grace. You see, if we come to the Lord and we get saved, the faith tells us this, that we are saved by faith. The Bible tells us that we're saved by grace through faith. Amen? And we need to understand that as we come to the Lord, that we are saved by faith. We are saved through grace, the grace of Jesus Christ. But we also need to understand that we're not saved to go and do whatever we want then after it. Hey, I'm saved again. I'll see you next when I at the end of my life, Jesus. You know, whatever that means. Or I'm going to live my life day to day, and I'm just going to pervert the grace of God. There are a lot of people within a lot of churches today who are blatantly perverting the grace of God. You know, one saint said, to be a Christian means to be being saved from sensuality and to sanctification. Let me read that again. To be a Christian means being saved from sensuality and to sanctification. Turn with me, please, to 1 Corinthians chapter 6 as we see Paul exemplifying and writing this almost this very thing. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, starting in verse 9. First Corinthians 6, verse 9. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, or idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Now look at here in verse 11. And such were some of you. He's basically saying the same thing as Jude. Look, this is who you were. It's not who you're to continue to be in Christ Jesus. We've been saved from those things. Notice he goes on in verse 11, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of God. Can I have an amen? You see, that's the radical part. When we're saved from all that garbage. Hey, when I take a bath, I don't know about you, but I don't want to go jump in a mud pile right after I'm done taking a bath. I want to try to stay clean. And you see, what we need to understand, there are a lot of people today who come to Christ, they want to profess Him, they want to take the grace, but then they want to go running right back to their sin. That's not a true Christian. There are a lot of people who are perverting the grace of God today within the church. There was a church that just opened up a few weeks ago, you know, and they don't believe that there was a literal Adam and Eve. They don't believe that that Jonah was swallowed by the whale. They don't believe a lot of the Old Testament, and yet they're out there saying that they're the real Christians. And you know what's starting to happen, and I don't know if you've seen it or not, but those of us who actually believe the Bible, who contend earnestly for the faith, we're starting to be called more and more haters, even by people within the church, because people have crept in. There are people who are teaching that you don't need to believe the Bible is the Word of God to be saved. There are people who are teaching that we don't need to believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. There are people who are teaching that we don't need to believe that Jesus is God. And they all say they're Christians. Are they right or are they wrong? I'll say this right now. They're wrong. You see, the church has been under attack since it began. Amen? Satan has tried all these different ways. And finally, in our day, because we are just so smart. Amen? Hey, we are so smart. We're smarter than any other generation that's come before us. Amen? And we're raising kids who are even smarter than us. Amen? Amen. Isn't it awesome? But we're smarter than the Word of God. Hey, I know better than the Word of God. I know better than this, or I know better than you. And the church is even under attack today. And by the way, though, with a frontal assault, for the last 15 years or so, the church has been under assault by homosexuality. Why do we talk about that so much? Because we're literally under attack by that, by those within those communities. I remember years ago being at Calvary Costa Mesa, and guys were, you know, outside protesting Calvary, and they came into the church, and they stood up, and they disrupted service, and, you know, all this different stuff. Just because, by the way, we had people that were going, and we knew some person that were going to Hollywood and witnessing. They didn't just go to Hollywood. They went to Huntington Beach and other places, but specifically in West Hollywood, there was a big homosexual community. They didn't like it. They didn't like it. And it's creeping now into the churches now. Homosexuality is creeping into the pulpits. It's spreading this false faith and a false gospel. And now it's spreading into what's called this whole thing, you know, with transgender, they call it. We used to call it cross-dressing. That's offensive now, so they call it a transgender. But when we do seek to contend for the faith, and we do seek to stand up and say, hey, you know what? What you're doing is sin, and if you continue to practice it, the Bible says that you're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. You know what we're called? That was very judgmental of you to say that. That was hateful. Matter of fact, you're homophobic. You're this-a-phobic. You're that-a-phobic. You're very judgmental. You're very intolerant. Oh, is that your tolerant judgment of me? Yeah. Even with this whole transgender issue, I've read many things from professing Christians who are very harsh with those who actually believe what the Bible says. Do you know God says that for a man to dress like a woman or a woman like a man, that it is a horrific thing to him? Do we understand that? And I've heard people say professing Christians have more harsh words for those who stand against this wickedness. Hey, yeah, let's let them use our bathrooms with our little kids. It's wicked. And again, just let me clarify this, though. We should never use harsh or unkind words when speaking about these people or to these people. Can I have an amen? Hey, I don't care what sin they're in. It doesn't make us better than them. We don't call them names. We don't speak to them about a certain way. And we need to watch our tones, people in our homes, in front of our kids. We need to watch our own hearts. If anything, if we see somebody like that being bullied, we need to stand up for them and die for them if need be. That's the gospel. But also, we need to be able to die for them as well by telling them the truth and not be afraid to contend earnestly for the faith once for all delivered to the saints. And it's getting more and more and more unpopular. People don't like the Bible anymore. It's outdated, they think. They don't realize that in it we have words of eternal life. We need to be those who are standing up within our culture, within our churches, and proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But we don't stop there, do we? Oh, that's sinful behavior. Never stop there, guys and gals. Always stop by, but you know what? Jesus died for that. And if we repent of our sins, Jesus said, and we come to him and we confess and we mourn over our sins and we believe upon him and receive him to be the Lord and Savior, we will be born again of the Spirit of God. We'll receive forgiveness at the cross. Isn't that glorious? Huh? Amen? Amen is glorious. And we need to hold the entire gospel. Yet these people in Jude's day were using the grace of God as an excuse to continue and practice their sin. And notice secondly, here at the end of our text in verse 4, at the end there it says, and they deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Can I ask us this morning, who is the master of your Lord, of your life this morning? Who's the master of your life? Who told you to come here this morning? Who told you to get up when the alarm went off and it's a beautiful day? Oh, dude, let's go to the beach. Let's go for a hike. Let's go golfing. Let's go do something outside. Amen? And that's what happens. People, hey, when is it kind of, because it's so funny, all the churches will talk, and it's like, well, when are people most likely just to kind of play hooky from church? When it's sunny and when it kind of maybe snows a drop or two, you know, in the Pacific Northwest. And that's us. That's all of us. That's our flesh. But we need to ask ourselves and examine ourselves sometimes, hey, is Jesus really my only? Notice where it says there, only master. Is he our only master? Or do I try to take on that role sometimes too? Can you have an amen?
Well, Lord, I think what's best right here is this, what I think. I've been a Christian for 30 years after all, and I think your word says something about that. I'm not sure.
You're not sure? Let's go get sure. What does God's word tell us in this situation? Because you know what, Lord, you're my master. Here's your word. Let me come, and you be the Lord. You be the master of my life. Not through what I feel. Oh, I feel, Lord, that you're telling me that it's okay that I divorce my wife and that I go off and marry this younger gal because I know you want me to be happy. Thanks, Lord. See you later. And you'd be shocked at how many people have said those very words to me. Leaving my wife, leaving my husband. God wants me to be happy. I'm like this. Show me. God wants you to be holy. And in that holiness, the true Christian will find joy and happiness. It's just a fact. Hey, if you're miserable, if you're hearing this stuff and this is miserable, I don't want Jesus to be the Lord of my life. I just want to be a Christian and go do what I want to do. Amen? I want to go and I want to be the captain of my own ship, the master of my own destiny. I want to do it my way. That's like a theme song, you know? When somebody dies or something really, whatever, they go back to these certain songs. You know, I call them the hymns of our culture. Somewhere Over the Rainbow, you know? Oh, this really tragic thing. Let's sing Somewhere Over the Rainbow. And I was thinking Dorothy, you know, and the little munchkins. Oh, this is so, dude. And the same thing with my way. Now the end is near. You know, whatever's clear, you know, but whatever whatever happens, I did it my way. You know, it's almost like somebody looking at God and going, I don't care about you. I did it my way. And I'm going straight to hell for all eternity. Isn't that exciting? Beloved in Christ, if these words are grinding on you this morning, there's something wrong with your walk with Jesus Christ. Because this is what God's word is telling us. And when I hear the words of my master, when a Christian hears the words of their master, they don't say, no, I don't want to do it. Or I want to do this, and how dare you tell me no that I can't do this. It should be, you know what, Lord, I'm having a hard time not doing this, but you're my master, and I know that by your spirit I can do all things, and I'm going to walk in faith with you. Yeah, I'm really tempted to this sin over here, but Lord, I'm going to do everything I can to cut it off. I'm going to pray, continue that you're going to lead me not into temptation. I'm going to walk in accordance with your word because you're my Lord, you're my master, and you tell me this in your word. Not because Pastor Bill tells you. What does God tell us through his word? And again, for the true Christian, you're going to hear, you know, I don't want to deny our only master and Lord Jesus Christ. This means he's the complete master of our lives. And if that still grinds on us, if I'm sitting here and it's like,
well, I know your word tells me I'm supposed to pray continually and have a prayer closet, but I don't have a prayer closet and I never will because I have my own way of praying.
You know what? There's something wrong with your Christianity. We don't like to hear that, do we?
I know I'm supposed to read the Bible, but I don't read it every day. I sometimes read it maybe once a week, and sometimes there. Have you ever read through the whole Bible? Well, not really. How long have you been a Christian? 50 years?
Well, I should have been through it 50 or 60 times by now.
I don't want to read the Bible.
Well, then you're denying your only master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Fasting. I don't want to fast.
I don't want to do these things. I don't want to. This is all about doing, Pastor Bill.
It's about Jesus being the Lord of our lives. As we go through the New Testament even, we see over and over and over the Lord telling us how to live, how not to live, how to be as Christians as he conforms us into the image of Jesus Christ. And it is the one who has been saved from the pit of hell, the one who has been saved from the cruel mastery of sin, that we are saved unto the good master of Jesus Christ. We talked about this last week as we become the doulos of Christ, slaves. And again, we got to remember that as Americans, the word slavery, doesn't it grind on us? Hey, I ain't nobody's slave, dude. I'll do what I want to do. Well, then we're denying the lordship and mastery of Jesus Christ. There are so many things that he's called us to do, so many things he's called us to believe and not to believe. And I'll be honest with you, I read these scriptures. And I think as a Calvary Chapel, I think as a church that is evangelical, we are probably some of the gravest offenders of taking God's grace for granted. We are. Well, it's no big deal if I don't do these things. It's all under grace. It's all grace, grace. Hey, God's grace is so radical. Hey, I came out of a church thinking I had to do all these different things to be saved and make sure I didn't go to purgatory and do all this stuff and made sure I wore a scapular so if I did die, I'd go straight to heaven, do all these things. And then I come and I start reading the Bible and it's by grace I'm saved, not by works. But he does go on to say you're saved unto good works. Well, how do we reconcile that? It's very easy how to reconcile it. Let's turn in our Bibles as we're closing to 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 15, I love how Paul says it here. And it's the Holy Spirit, by the way, breathing through Paul, the apostle. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 10. By the way, I'd encourage you to highlight this verse, underline it, memorize it. 1 Corinthians, verse 10. But by the grace of God, notice he talks about grace. By the grace of God, I am what I am. Can I have an amen? Amen. And his grace towards me was not in vain. On the contrary, notice what the grace led to. He said, on the contrary, I worked harder than any of them.
though it was not I, but the grace of God that is within me. What did the grace of God bring Paul to do? What does it say there? He worked harder than any of the other apostles. Why? I think it's because he probably received the most grace. Remember, he came at the end of his life, dude, I am the chief of all sinners. Paul was a man who had learned that when he was weak, he could be strong by the grace of God. Oh, beloved in Christ, that we would not be guilty this morning of being those who are not walking in the lordship of Jesus Christ, who are not contending earnestly for the faith once for all delivered. Because I tell you what, man, as I read these last words of Paul, I am just, Lord, give me more of your grace so I can serve and love you more. Glorious, glorious stuff. Let's pray. Father, as we read these words, your word, Lord, given to us by Jude, I pray that we would examine ourselves, Lord. I pray that we would examine our lives. Lord, I pray, Lord, for those even here this morning that are bored this morning by your word, Lord, I pray for those of us who are wandering eyes and hearts, Lord, so easy as our flesh just wants to have us ignore all these things, but I pray that your word again would find that good soil. Lord, that everything I said that's not of you would be forgotten, but all your word would remain and have come back 10, 100-fold in these people's lives here. Lord, that we would choose to walk after you, Lord, that we would choose to be those who love you and those who are filled with your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand together.